been getting a lot of questions recently about how I go about creating a piece like this in Procreate, what some of my steps are, how long things like this take. So let's talk about that in today's video. Cool. So first things first, I did not think of this off the top of my head. This is Zeus, a very famous figure already.
Oh, Zeus, most potent of gods.
And I did this from reference. As someone who's learning realism, I can't just pull this stuff out of my head. Let's have a look at the reference image I used and how I ended up creating this in Procreate. So this is the image here, which I saw and I was like, you know what? I'm going to draw that. I want to get as close as I can as possible to recreating this and really having a look at that shading, that depth, and see how I can go about drawing Zeus in Procreate. When it comes to realism, I'm really trying to push myself as an artist, and I love the way this turned out. Now, to show you how I did this exactly, I'm going to have to go back and show you the original file. Now, what I mean by that is this file here, I bought the sketch in, which I'd done previously, onto this paper texture on the background. It was just a paper texture I picked up from a company last year. I can't even remember. And I just really like the look of it. I think it added to the overall sketch aesthetic. So what we're going to do, we're going to jump back into our gallery, and right next to it in the stack, which I created for this piece, we have the original sketch. Very, very harsh on the white background, which, as you can see, is probably why I ended up wanting to put it on that really nice sort of dark tan paper in the end. But first things first, I wanted to draw from reference. So what was I going to do? I was going to use my reference capabilities in Procreate. We're going to tap on our action tab at the top here. We're going to make sure we have canvas selected, and we're going to turn on reference, and we're going to see here, this is the reference image I used. Now, I did a few things first. As you can see, I have a grid overlay on top of this piece here, and then I have all these numbers and letters running down horizontally and vertically of this piece here. This is a very old technique that I picked up. I learned this from an oil painter years and years and years ago. It's something that I still adapt into my drawings these days. It allows me to draw, but also refer to certain points, making sure I'm getting the right sort of layout. I'm making sure I'm getting the right key points in the right areas. So before last year, I had not really done realism at all. So this is a whole new learning curve for me, but I know oil painters have done this for centuries and centuries. So I couldn't have been that bad of a technique, but how did I get this? All right, so if we jump into my layers panel on the top right, you're going to see I have all these different sketch layers, which we'll talk about in a second. But on this layer at the bottom, I have the numbers and letters, which you can see on the reference image here. Now, how did I get this image in my reference image? Essentially, I have to save this, and I'll show you exactly how I did that. But before we do, you're going to notice there's grid lines on the reference image as well. So for that, we're going to tap back on our actions tab at the top, and then you're going to see there's a few options under canvas here, not reference, but just above that, we have the drawing guide. If we turn this on, we have the ability to edit it. And what I did is I created these little squares, which across this piece, there was enough room in each of them for me to sort of see what was going on. They weren't too small. They also weren't too big. I had these reference points, which I could work around or work through, and they turned out to be really vital. So as you can see on the right here, I have the grid, and I also have my numbers and letters in each of those. So from here, I would export that image. And then when I came back into Procreate with a blank canvas, I could go back to my actions tab, tap on reference again, and import from my camera roll the image with grid and number letter system ready to go, ready to draw. This is one of the best suggestions I can give to anyone out there who wants to learn about drawing realism. It is not easy. You will spend a lot of time on this. Let's utilize everything we can in terms of tools to be able to get the best results we can and really train our eye. And again, I'm trying to replicate an exact image here. There's nothing wrong with using a grid system. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Also, let me know down in the comments below if you've ever used a grid system when it comes to your drawing before. I'd love your input or feedback or advice, or just let's have a chat. All right, so from here, I would have had all of these turned off, and I would have started building my sketch around my reference image right here. Now, this is the beauty of Procreate. I can keep this reference image up, and I can go ahead and start sketching. What I'll show you from here is I'm going to show you the first layer that I created. And this is my really basic sketch outline layer. And I would remove my pencil. I'd draw things across while occasionally looking at this reference image on the left. And I could make sure that, you know what, that bottom of the ear, you know, where are we at? That bottom of the ear sort of comes in M and N on 6 and 7. So it's a way for you to draw and sort of see, you know what, I nailed that. Like, that's in the exact right spot. Or, you know what, I'm really off with that. Let me just kind of sharpen that up a little bit. And that's how that layer sort of came about. But from there, it was really time to bring in the shading. But this particular piece, I wanted this look of this statue, but I wanted to keep it very sketchy as much as possible. That's not sketchy as in dodgy, that's sketchy as in sketchy. So from here, I was really thinking about sort of keeping this layer, but adding onto it as I went. And then you can see I started creating these layers over the top. So what I did first is this next layer, I used a pastel. If I go back to my sketching folder, I chose this soft pastel. And as you can see here, it was a really, really nice way to add a texture in on the background, but not have it be too harsh. Essentially what I came in and did was I left my opacity all the way up on this brush. I filled in the whole layer. I cut it out with an eraser, but then I came back in on this layer and I dropped that opacity down to give it a really nice light, soft feel so that when I do drop my shading elements in over the top of that, my values bringing them up, making them a lot darker. I wasn't doing it straight on white. Please experiment with this sort of a layer. As you can see in this face here, if you look at the face compared to the background is stark white, but the face never goes to that really, really white color. That's what we did. That's what this layer is here for. So from there, I had a look at the image and I said, you know what? I probably want to get this really dark shadow in where the neck is. It's coming down across the front of his neck, under his beard, onto his shoulder. So that was that next layer. I worked with the exact same brush again, that pastel, and I dropped in at 100%, make sure I was following where this shadow was hitting on the neck, but then I dropped the opacity down on it again, just kind of match what I was seeing here. And at this point, I am not worried about this being perfect at all. I want to rough in what I'm seeing. If we go to the next layer from there, I started working on the shoulder down on the left. I thought it had some strong values in it, and it was something which wasn't going to require as much attention as the face and the beard. As you can see, I dropped in some really nice dark values in here, kind of matched that shoulder quite nicely. The brush I used on that layer, again, was that pastel brush. I thought it was really effective in creating this darker value, but working in with the layers below it previously. Now, this is a really important thing. We don't want to go and use all these hard airbrushes on the top of this because it's not going to match in with those pastels that we laid below it. Now, the next layer, we really started to look at some of the harder shadow points in the face, beard, neck, whatever it was. Let me turn that on and off again. Just going to minimize my reference layer a little bit so you can see what's going on in these layers here. If I turn that on and off, I've worked more on the shoulder down here. I've got a lot of the shading in the neck happening as well, and I have started to drop some shading in the face and the nose as well, but I haven't gone too crazy at all. This is where I'm really just starting to experiment with what's going to work, and by experimenting, I mean I was using a different brush here. So this isn't actually in my sketching brush folder, but if I go to a folder that I have called crosshatching, this is a pack of brushes I bought years and years and years ago. I love this. If you're ever familiar with the sketching form that is crosshatching, it is so vital. It goes all the way back to Da Vinci.
By Leonardo da Vinci.
It's absolutely beautiful to look at. Now, these brushes are going to replicate what could take much, much, much longer to do. Let's have a look at me drawing with one. You can see it's going to create that effect. And the beauty of the Apple Pencil is I can start really hard with that brush, but I can fade it off as well. So I can have a nice gradient in there. And already you can see using a brush like this is going to be really, really effective at creating some nice depth, but it's not going to be, again, a really hard airbrush, which is going to be super hard to create the effect we want. It's also going to look really nice over the top of this pastel layer as well. That looks simple, right? You're probably looking there going, oh, he just used one brush and it was super easy. It was most definitely not, I can promise you that. These brushes, like any brushes, take a very long time to get, I don't want to say good at, but effective at, you know. There's always different ways to use them, and I've kind of developed my own style. For instance, with this particular crosshatching brush, I like the number 8. It's my favorite, but I also don't have the opacity turned all the way up on the left-hand side here on the toolbar. You can see it's probably at about 66% or something around there. So this layer was really experimenting with this brush, sort of seeing if it's going to work, seeing if I like it. And then the next layer from there, this is where things started to get a lot more intense in the drawing. I'm going to solo this layer for a minute. And you can see I've worked with the pastel brush a little bit. I've also worked with the crosshatching brush. But here I actually have started to use an airbrush as well. I did use the soft airbrush to really darken up a few of the values, which we can see You know, some of these parts of the hair here are pretty much solid black. I did want to make sure I distinguished between the really pretty much black areas of his hair, beard, all that sort of stuff, into what we're seeing in the face and the neck and all those sort of other areas. So yeah, this was a really defining layer. As you can see, once I got that turned on, it really started to add a lot of the depth. But I think the reason why this really started to take shape here was because of the work we'd done on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 layers below it, right? It was something where I was able to drop darker values on his left-hand side, which would be on my right or your right when you're looking at it, down here on the right, specifically under his ear as well, you know, quite a lot of dark values in there, which works well because when we come onto the neck, dropping even darker values in there, we've also got that shading which is already sitting there. So overall, you can see how a piece like this, personally, I think requires many, many layers, and you're building up as you go. Let's have a look at the next layer. If we solo this layer, you can see how extremely light a lot of these are, using the crosshatching brush only on this layer. Actually looks quite cool when I have it soloed by itself. I really like that. But as you can see here again, the darker spots I've got through this whole layer are around his ear, behind his ear here, up on his cheekbone, kind of in the nose area, up around the top of the hair on the corner here, and then under the beard as well. Let's get that layer back in with all the others. And you can see by this point, I've left the eyes out, the eyes and the forehead, because this part I really wanted to focus on. And I think it's such an important part of realism, is getting, you know, the eyes and eyebrows, forehead, that sort of area, you know, really, really nice. And I really wanted to give it the attention that it deserved. And it's an area I've been working on personally a lot. So from here, let's look at the next layer. Very small layer, this one. All I did was add in the corner of Zeus's right eye. And what I've done here is, if you look at this reference image, I'm really just starting to mimic what I'm seeing. I'm trying to figure out the size of my crosshatching brush so I can get in, make a lot of these lines look really nice. And overall, at this point, it's coming together nicely. I'm pretty happy with the rest of the piece as well. And then if we add on the very last layer, which takes this whole artwork to another level, it is these eyes in here. So if I minimize this, I'm going to show you Zeus here. Is it perfect? No, not at all. Is it effective and gets what I want across? Yeah, I definitely think it does. And you can notice what I've done here as well. By leaving the original sketch layer in there, it's added another layer of texture in there, and it's helped with things like the crease lines across the forehead, which are meant to be very, very faint. But when you do zoom out, you don't really focus on those. I really like this style and this technique, which overall creates what I think is a pretty nice looking piece. And let's jump back into these layers here. Let's turn those eyes on and off. I mean, you can see the difference there automatically. Could I get back in and do a lot more work in those eyes? Of course I could. But overall, if we zoom out a little bit, we're going to turn our numbers off, and we're going to jump back into action panel and turn our drawing guide off. You know, when we zoom out and we have a look at the reference compared to mine, obviously I've used a red brush, which is where I could come through, open up my panels. I could merge all of these layers by pinching together my fingers on the layers that I want to merge. I could jump into my adjustments layer, go to hue, saturation, and brightness, and I could bring the brightness down. And then I've got a piece which, you know, looks, I think, very similar to the original reference image, but I actually quite like keeping the original red sketch look and vibe to the piece. And that's how I created this piece. Was it easy? By no means. The first couple of hours into a piece like this, I was always second guessing myself. I thought, this looks terrible. You know, what am I doing? Why am I doing this? As always with pieces like this, I've probably created about 8 to 10 realism pieces over the last year. It's not until those last few hours on the design where everything really starts to come together. You know, for example, if we look at these layers, I'm just going to undo merging all of those, take out the eyes, the eyebrow, and the crosshatching over the top. You know, this was looking pretty basic at this point, and I really was questioning myself. To add those in takes it to a whole other level. Now, I know what you're wondering, statistics, how long does it take to create a piece like this? Well, luckily, Procreate, keep that in mind when you are designing. We're going to tap on the Actions tab on the top left hand of the screen. We're going to go to Canvas, and right at the bottom, we have Canvas information. This is really vital as well. If you are going to sell your art, give your art away, anything like that, we can put our information in here. We can sign it, and then whoever gets that piece is going to know who that was created by, when it was created, when it was last modified as well. I really like this area. But then we have statistics. So on this piece, as you can see on the screen, my total strokes made were 12,196. It's around 7 hours in the piece, and the total file size is getting close to 1 gigabyte. So that's how, when you're looking at these pieces with a lot of layers, a lot of information on them, they really can add up. But the other thing that's going to affect that total file size is the video settings. Now, I always have mine set to 4K lossless. I want to record the highest quality video because I do share my videos with people online. If I hit done here, we've still got our menu open at the top. If I was to tap on video here under the actions tab, I could have a look at my time-lapse replay. But at the start, you saw this piece on a different canvas. From there, what I did was, again, I pinched all my layers together to merge them, tapped on that layer, I copied the layer. What I did though, before I jumped out of that canvas, because this canvas will autosave, I did make sure after I've got my layer copied, I'm gonna tap with both fingers on the screen twice, and it's gonna bring all my layers back, but the merged layer has still been copied. So I can hit gallery from here, I could open up another canvas, and then all I would have to do was go actions, add, and then paste, and it's going to paste that in on another canvas. And as you can see here, this type of paper I think really added to the original sketch feel and created a piece which, you know, I'm really happy with it in the end. And it took a long time, but I think sometimes the best things in life do. But that's how I created this piece in Procreate in around 7 hours. So get out there, give these techniques a go. I think you're going to find them really, really useful. And the biggest thing I can tell you is to keep trying. Remember, the first half to three quarters of this process, it's not going to look like what it's going to look like in the end, but you're laying the foundation to get better and better. Let me know if you love drawing realism down below, or if you use some of the tips that I use here today, because I'd love to have a chat and see how others create. And as always, don't forget to subscribe, because it allows me to bring you these videos each and every week. So until the next video, I'll catch you then.